I am a Trump addict. I think I'm willing to admit that. I think all roads lead to Trump right now. But you pointed out in a recent column that that can be a problem. How so?
So, I mean, and let me express my own addiction as well. You know, my wife and I, we find ourselves, our pillow talk is sometimes about Trump.
But terrible.
But I do think that we have to acknowledge that there is so much more happening in the world than Donald Trump. And we in the media are essentially all Trump all the time. And frankly, it's a little rude to say this, but I think cable television is particularly true, or cable TV.
It is, yeah.
And the upshot is that we risk not covering a lot of really important things at home and around the world. And we complain that President Trump is, you know, is parochial, isn't paying attention to important things around the world, and we're absolutely right. But that can also be said about us.
Well, there's always been a critique of the American press that it's too focused on politics, Washington inside baseball, and not focused enough on real-world issues that affect communities. And I guess the point is that's even more true now because Trump sucks up all the oxygen.
I think that's part of it. And also, I think, frankly, that there's obviously a crisis in journalism, and our old business model has been collapsing. And then along came Trump, and he's a bit of the solution to our business model. As long as we have cameras focused on him, then audiences will follow.
Now, that's interesting that you said that. He brought up something similar at his rally a few days ago. Here's what he said.
So I said, unless they give me an extension for the presidency, which I don't think the fake news media would be too happy about. Wait. Actually, they would be happy, because when I'm not here, their ratings are going to sink.
Now, I don't think that's entirely true, but there is a Trump bump that we've seen in television ratings, in New York Times subscriptions,
et cetera.
So I suppose on an individual and an institutional basis, we have to reckon with this.
Yeah, and I think we have to acknowledge it. You know, in 2016, frankly, I think we in the media, to some extent, blew a historic election because we were so relieved that there was somebody we could cover that would generate these subscriptions. And then, as you remember, there was some anxiety in newsrooms that then Hillary Clinton was going to be elected and government would be boring again and our audiences would desert us. Well, I mean, that did not happen.
Isn't this really about proportionality? Here's part of the column you wrote. I'm not arguing that we avert our eyes from Trump or mute our criticism. Far from it. But we have to figure out how to spare bandwidth for the genocide in Myanmar, opioids in America, and so on.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we're focused on one conflict, which is basically the Washington conflict. And that's important. And we've got to cover that. But there are all these others out there as well. And that I don't think we're adequately covering those, and you know, for very understandable reasons. If it's easy for me to write this as a columnist, because you know, I'm far enough the game. I can write columns that only my mother will read, and that's fine. But if I were executive producer of a TV show, I can understand that if I sent a camera crew off to Myanmar to write about the genocide against the Rohingya, then my audience is going to drop compared to a rival network that puts a Democrat and a Republican in a studio together and has them yell at each other. And that's a real problem. And I don't really have a solution to that.
You also wrote in the column, quote, the biggest Trump scandals aren't those unfolding in Washington, but those devastating the lives of poor and vulnerable people in distant American towns. Again, that's harder to cover, and the resources are not always there. But I really like the way you frame the scandal, the real scandal, being outside Washington.
That's right. I mean, I come from a part of Oregon that has that is indeed pro-Trump, in part because it did get neglected and because there has been a real crisis. You know, American life expectancy has gone down 2 years in a row, whereas in the rest of the industrialized world, it's gone up. And if this were happening because of terrorism, we'd be all over it. But it's happening in really boring, non-dramatic ways through suicide, through alcohol abuse, through drugs, because of a crisis in work, a crisis in self-esteem, a crisis in employment, in living standards. And I think we have kind of dropped the ball on that, and it helped elect President Trump, I believe, and I think in turn his policies are going to magnify that problem.
What a thought that if these people were dying from terrorism, there'd be wall-to-wall coverage right here. But because it happens in the shadows, one at a time, it's almost invisible to us.
Yeah, and that invisible America, if you will, I think is one that, because we don't cover it adequately, because we don't talk about it, we don't develop good policies to address it. I think that as a nation, we tend to have our worst policies towards issues that are difficult to talk about or that are invisible. We can be part of the solution. We can help leverage these issues and, you know, put them on the agenda. Mm. And it's hard, and we have to figure out how to build a business model for that kind of thing. But maybe a starting point is to have a conversation about that.